guys for so much for coming. If you're still coming in and you didn't hear me before, I'm going to go off this slide, but I'll leave it up here. I'm really interested in the topic, and we're going to come into this a little bit during this talk about motivation in the Drupal community and what motivates people in the first place to spend a whole bunch of time working on this project, which is just such a complicated issue. So if you could share with me and with everyone kind of what motivates you by tweeting to this hashtag Drupal Motivation, that'd be great. We'll come back to it a little bit later in the talk. All right, so let's go ahead and get started. The name of this talk is Building a Learning Community Through Competition. And I'll explain a little bit about where I'm coming from in a second. But thank y'all for coming out. It's a huge room, but it's all good. So just really quickly, a little bit about me, just so you might have some idea of who it is you're listening to. My name is Mike Hayden. I'm a freelance Drupal developer, which basically means I spend a lot of time playing Call of Duty at home in my underwear. We're actually going to come back to Call of Duty and video games in a second. That's just a joke. I do actually develop for Drupal. I used to be a high school teacher. I used to be a science, math, and computer science teacher. And I'm really interested in kind of the overlaps between education and the Drupal community and also the Drupal software project and education. There's a picture of me in front of some kids. I've done a little bit of work on core, and I've done a little bit of work on some contrib modules. I have some fun little modules I've done myself, and I maintain EVA, it's Entity Views Attachment. It's on a bunch of sites. If you haven't checked it out, it's a really useful module. I suggest you do. But the thing that I think brings me here to talk to you today about motivation, about learning, and about competition is this site that I started that's called The Module Off. You can just raise your hand if you've ever heard of The Module Off before. Okay, cool. So about half of you, maybe. I'll get into some details later about The Module Off itself. It's a Drupal developer competition that I've been using to try and motivate people to contribute. We'll talk a little bit more about it later. So real quickly, the teacher in me says before I give a talk, I'm supposed to discuss the goals first. So what I want to do is talk about motivation in open source. I want to talk about the module off and the lessons I've learned building it. And I want to talk about the motivational tools that we have in the Drupal community already and also the tools from other communities. Here's how we're going to do it. I'm going to start by telling a couple of my story coming into Drupal and maybe kick it back to your stories. We'll talk about some motivational research about how motivation works in open source and otherwise. Talk about the Drupal community tools, the module off itself, and then some tools from other communities, and then maybe I'll ask you to do something at the end. Okay, so I'll just really, really briefly tell you about my story coming into the module off, or coming into Drupal. I sort of fell into Drupal by accident. I used to be a high school teacher, like I said, and like every high school teacher, you wear like 20 different hats, and I was just sort of the guy that knew something about technology, and they said, hey, we'd like to have an intranet. Can you build that for us? You know something about computers? I said, yeah, I guess. I don't know. I had web hosting. And I went to their, to their console, and there was like a bunch of one-click installations. There was one for Drupal, and there was one for WordPress. And I thought the little drop thing for Drupal was kind of cool, so I clicked on that and installed it. And since that day, I've been doing Drupal, quite a bit. And then, when I was just interested in the software, it was really useful, so I kept using it. I started coming to the meetups in Boston, and that's when I started being really interested in the idea of contributing to core. At that time, the meetup in Boston was really undergoing this Drupal ladder process. Can you raise your hand if you ever heard of the Drupal ladder before? Okay, not as many. That's good. I guess that means I'm doing something. The Drupal ladder idea is a series of kind of lessons and steps that will take you from I've never contributed to core before to I'm like a deep Drupal contributor. And I think it's Brian Hurst that's a big part of this and some other folks. And that was a big part of my first experience when I was starting to go to this Drupal meetup. It inspired me to get started with core in the first place. This is a tweet from 474 days ago. This is one of my first ever tweets. And it says, first core Drupal patch committed by Webchick, woohoo. Most of y'all don't know me, but for me to put woohoo in a tweet is kind of a big deal. So, I think that feeling, that elation that I had, committed something or something that I had done had been put into the Drupal project on the whole was just a spectacular feeling. And I don't know if any of you have ever had this feeling before, but it felt amazing. And this is not a deep patch. I think this was a docs patch that was like she fixed a grammar mistake in somebody's documentation, right? But I felt so good that I had done it that I even said woohoo in a tweet, which is a big deal. And then I came to that camp last year and met a bunch of contributors and really started to get a little bit more involved in core. So what I discovered in doing that is that contributing to Drupal is really hard. And if you ever tried to do anything with Drupal 8 so far, you might have encountered this this image before. It says the number of new concepts to learn in Drupal 8 is too damn high. It's true. It's really difficult to get into this in the first place. And so I became really, really interested in the idea of what motivates these people. Who are these people that are contributing to Drupal 8 all the time? This super, super challenging work. Who are they? And what's their motivation for doing it in the first place? Because it's very, very difficult stuff to do. So let's talk about that for a few seconds. I'm interested in what the answer is for you all as well. So I'm going to kind of go down this list a little bit and read off some Drupal motivation tweets. So what I said is that I contributed to Drupal because I want to be ready for Drupal 8 when it arrives. Mark said, you know, he started contributing to Drupal because writing modules and fixing things is more fun than checking boxes, which is definitely true. Identifying common solutions to problems, sharing fixes we discovered in our environment, so that's kind of that community feel. Blake also said the same thing, repaying his debts to the community, helping people is fun. You guys are giving me the answers exactly that I was looking for. Thank you so much. I want to help create great websites that help hundreds of thousands of students in California in higher education. Awesome. I already saw that one. Somebody retweeted it. And this person is new but wants to get started, so that's a great person for them to be here. So I guess my point is, if you look at those tweets for a lot of different people, right, the answer was they want to help other people. They want to be a part of something big. They want to be a part of a community, and I think that's spectacular. We're going to get into that a little bit deeper into this. I was going to have you all kind of turn to the person next to you, but everybody's so spread out, so we're going to skip them. Have you ever heard this phrase before, right, that people talk about Drupal? They say all the time, come for the code and stay for the community, right? People come originally because the code is really useful, but they end up staying because everybody is really great to work with. This is an image of the code in Drupal 8 and how it has changed from all the way from 4 up to 8. You can see 4 on the far left and Drupal 8 on the far right. This comes from this guy, David. He has a bunch of excellent infographics about the size of the code base. So you can see the code is really expanding quite a bit. And so to me, that means that we really also need to increase the number of people and the processes that we have for bringing in the number of people who can contribute to core, can look at core, can teach people how to use Drupal. All these things are going to have to increase for us to keep up with the pace at which the code base is also increasing. So not only does the code increase, but our community tools need to get better as well. And here's another tweet. This one's from XJM, but it's actually quoting Angie. It says, Drupal 8's going to come out. You can either get hit by the bus that is Drupal 8, or you can get involved now and help shape it. I think that's so true, right? And if you just saw the number, was anybody here for the last session before this one? Yeah. It was about converting your modules from Drupal 7 to Drupal 8. And another example of how there's just so many new things in Drupal 8, it's extremely difficult to just jump in and get started. So the earlier you can get in here and take a look, the better. So all of this questions about motivation, about how difficult it is to contribute to core, this brings me to the fundamental question for this talk here, which is, working on core, or contributing to Drupal, or learning Drupal, all of these things are really hard, they take a lot of time, and you need motivation to complete them. I think we actually do a really, really good job of supporting new contributors, right? If you're coming here for the first time, there's Drupal, there's core office hours, there's really good documentation in line. There's so many, there's people at IRC who will help you just for the sake of it. There's so many great people and tools that you can have to learn Drupal. But what's motivating people to do it in the first place, right? And what's actually motivating people to keep going once they get in there? I think that's a different problem, and I'm not sure it's one we've touched on at all. Okay, so let's talk about motivation, because I think that's really important. Like I just said, I think that's a really important thing for us to start addressing. So, like I said, I come from a teaching background, so a lot of this stuff comes from kind of cognitive science and educational psychology. So one of the big things to talk about is extrinsic motivation versus intrinsic motivation. Extrinsic motivation is what is the traditional sense of motivation, right? You think about carrots and sticks, right? You think about a donkey, where if you hold a carrot in front of them, the donkey's going to go forward. It provides a little bit of motivation. It's a reward for somebody for doing the thing that you want them to do, okay? And there's the opposite. There's the stick. You can punish people for doing the thing you don't want them to do. This is called extrinsic motivation because it provides motivation external to the person. Right? You're saying, do this because I'm going to do something else, right? There's something outside of the person that's motivating them to do it. There's a separate type of motivation that's called intrinsic motivation. Intrinsic motivation is internally generated. It's something that you do because you think it's a cool thing to do. It's because you think it's the right thing to do. You do it for its own sake. when you're intrinsically motivated to do something, you do something because it makes you feel great. It makes you feel like a Superman character, like you're flying through the air. You've done this thing because it feels good to do. You understand the difference? Right? Extrinsic motivators, like, I'm getting paid to do this. Intrinsic motivators, like, I think this is really interesting. That's what I'm doing. Economics people, right, they study a lot about extrinsic motivators because they think about, oh, how much should we pay people to do this or not do this? Or how much should we take away from people if they're not performing as the way we're at? Psychologists like to think about intrinsic motivation, and there's a lot of research that's going into this right now is to figure out, okay, which one of these is better? And it turns out, all else being equal, a bunch of studies have shown that people will do better if they're intrinsically motivated to do it, if they're doing it because they think it's cool. Give you an example. Smokers who quit, they did a survey of a bunch of smokers both before and after they quit smoking, and they asked them, what were the reasons why you quit smoking? And the people who said that they quit because they thought it was the right thing to do or they thought about it was worth it for their own health, these people were way more likely to successfully quit than the people who didn't, who tried to quit because of social pressures, right? They decided they wanted to quit smoking because people thought that it was gross or something, and that's why they wanted to quit. Those people were not successful. The people who decided to smoke for decided to stop smoking for themselves, they were the people who were way more successful. And this applies also in schools. Students who are already intrinsically motivated do something, do better at it, and they can also have that intrinsic motivation turned off by extrinsic motivators. This is a really interesting study. So they took a bunch of kindergartners, or I think they were first graders, and they just sent them out on free play. They had a bunch of different activities that they could do. They could be playing with blocks, they could be playing with crayons, it didn't matter, and they let them do whatever they wanted to do. And then they gathered up all the kids who chose to do crayons when they were doing that. These kids were intrinsically motivated, they were just super down with crayons. And they gathered up those kids, and they took them into a separate room later, and they split those kids then into three groups. One of the groups, they said, here's some crayons, if you want to play with crayons, rock on. Then they had a second group, and they said, listen, we got some crayons here. I'll give you a cookie if you play with the crayons. And then they had a third group of kids that they played with the crayons, and then they gave them a cookie afterwards without saying anything to them. So basically, there were three groups. There was one group that they just left them up to their intrinsic motivation to use the crayons. And there were two other groups that afterwards they provided rewards, some extrinsic motivators. When they put all the kids back in the general population, the kids were running around doing whatever it is they want to do, and they found that the kids who were originally intrinsically motivated, to use the crayons, if they got cookies, they didn't want to use the crayons anymore because they were expecting cookies after that, right? And now they only want to do the cookies if they're going to get paid to do the cookies. And I think this is a really important lesson for us as we're thinking about ways to motivate people, right? If there's Drupal developers out there who are doing it because they think it's awesome, we're talking about paying them or giving them points or something like that for doing it. We don't want to shut people down and have people not contribute if they're expecting points and we're not giving them. So we'll get to that a little bit later, but that's a really interesting example. I think also the entire open source movement is a really interesting study in extrinsic and intrinsic motivation. So many different projects and people who contribute to these things, they're not getting paid to do it. They're doing it for free, right? A lot of the time. And they're doing it because they think it's interesting, they think it's a difficult problem to take on. So that's just a really interesting thing on intrinsic motivation. I'm going to show this video, about a couple minutes from this video, by a guy named Dan Pink. The name of the song is Drive, The Surprising Truth About What Motivates Us. And this is animated by somebody on a whiteboard. This video is super interesting, and I can't play it all because we don't have enough time, but I'm just going to start it right when we start talking about open source stuff a little bit.
Nothing interesting. Let me just get out of your way. One day, autonomy produces things that never emerge. Now, let's talk about mastery. Mastery is our urge to get better at stuff. We like to get better at stuff. This is why people play musical instruments on the weekend. You have all these people who are acting in ways that seem irrational economically. They play musical instruments on weekends. Why? It's not going to get them a mate. It's not going to make them any money. Why are they doing it? Because it's fun. Because you get better at it, and that's satisfying. Go back in time a little bit. I imagine this if I went to my first economics professor, a woman named Mary Alice Shulman, and I went to her in 1983 and said, Professor Shulman, can I talk to you after class for a moment? Yeah. I got this inkling. I got this idea for a business model. I just want to run it past you. Here's how it would work. You get a bunch of people around the world who are doing highly skilled work, but they're willing to do it for free and volunteer their time 20, sometimes 30 hours a week. Okay, she's looking at you somewhat skeptically there. Oh, but I'm not done. then what they create, they give it away rather than sell it. It's going to be huge. But you want to think, really, what if I was insane? Okay, you seem to fly in the face of some of the things, but what do you have? You have Linux powering 1 out of 4 corporate servers in Fortune 500 companies, Apache powering more than the majority of web servers, Wikipedia. What's going on? Why are people doing this? Why are these people, many of whom are technically sophisticated, highly skilled people who have jobs, okay? They have jobs. They're working at jobs for pay, doing challenging, doing sophisticated technological work. And yet, during their limited discretionary time, they do equally, if not more, technically sophisticated work, not for their employer, but for someone else for free. That's a strange economic behavior. Economists have looked into it. Why are they doing this? It's overwhelmingly clear. Challenge and mastery along with making a contribution. That's it.
You said challenge and mastery along with making a contribution, and that's it. These three points are his big ones that, you know, people are motivated to work on these open source projects because it's a challenge, it's difficult, and they want to take it on, just like climbing a mountain. Mastery, because it's going to make them better programmers for having gotten involved in the first place, and making a contribution, being a part of a larger community, and feeling like the work you're doing is of value. All three of those things, pretty much intrinsic motivators, right? Big, powerful types of motivation that you're going to contribute to this just because you think it's interesting to do. I've been hating on extrinsic motivation a little bit too hard, though. I think it has a place, and let me explain another sort of movement from education and how I think it could apply over here, and already does apply in some open source communities. Extrinsic motivators are not entirely bad, particularly for these like short, non-complex tasks. They work really well. So for example, if I ask you to carry a bunch of rocks from one end of the stage to the other, you're not going to do that because it gives you a warm, fuzzy feeling for the community, right? You're going to want a couple of dollars for that, right? That's something that requires extrinsic motivation. Let me tell you a really, really interesting example also of extrinsic motivation and how it could apply. There's a company called Autodesk. They build like 3D modeling software. It's used in movies and things like that. And they were looking at their data, and they saw that people who downloaded their free trial were likely to install it once. They weren't very likely to buy it. If they installed it, tried it a couple of times, then they would definitely buy the software. Their numbers went way up if people tried it a few times. So what they did was they gamified the free trial process, which is ridiculous, right? You just download a free trial of software. Well, no. For Autodesk, you download the free trial, and then there's a scoreboard of how many different things you tried doing inside the software. You don't just download and install it. You're competing with other people to, like, really utilize the free trial. You know, that seems so silly, but people, for whatever reason, when they see a leaderboard, they get into it. And they, you know, these people are conjuring it, and their sales numbers from people downloading free trials went up by 40% just because they put a leaderboard in there. There wasn't anything else more to it. They aimed it to be like kind of an adventure, this undiscovered territory. You know, people's psychology is really manipulative. You can really manipulate it just by these really simple techniques. And we're talking about a 40% jump in sales from free trial participants. That's like a very large number. So the point is that these badges and achievements have also been shown in education to, you know, increase student achievement. So they'll do better on tests afterwards if you can motivate them to do these repetitive tasks, particularly with badges. I don't know if you've heard of Khan Academy or some other websites that are trying to coach kids through learning activities. If you're going through a bunch of problems in a math problem set, hey, it'd be nice to say if I got 5 in a row, I get a little bonus. You know, some little colorful thing on the screen. It seems silly. It seems meaningless because it's just some, you know, ephemeral digital thing. It doesn't, I can't take it to the pawn shop and get $5 for it, but for whatever reason, it motivates us. On the other hand, a lot of studies in education have shown what I was discussing before, that if we give people badges for things that they would do on their own, that they don't need badges for, then they come to expect badges, and they do worse if they don't get them. So we have to be really careful when we design them. So the key point, once again, for these extrinsic motivators is that gamification, these badges, points, leaderboards, stuff like that, it can get people in the door, it can get them started, especially when they have to start with these junky, kind of, you know, not that fun tasks in the beginning, these repetitive tasks. But then over time, you need to kind of transfer over to intrinsic motivation because the badges are going to lose their value. You're not going to rewrite the entire, Drupal 8 routing system if you, to get the Drupal 8 routing system badge. That's not going to work, right? But it might help you to contribute some documentation in the very beginning when you're learning how to do it. Okay, so that's a little bit of the research around motivation in general and around kind of education and how it might apply here. Let's let's look at some of the tools that the Drupal community has already to try and motivate people. Let's take a look.
Can you raise your hand if you ever heard of certifiedtorock.com?
Okay, yeah. So this came out from Greg Kanatis and a bunch of other guys from Growing Venture Solutions a couple of years ago. And the idea here was that it formed out of the debate over kind of certification in Drupal, right? People were saying, if you ever tried to hire a Drupal developer before, you might find you get a bunch of applicants who are not exactly Drupal developers, right? Maybe they speak a little PHP, maybe they've done a little WordPress in Drupal here, you know what I mean? And so there was this idea that, well, maybe we should come up with a Drupal certification. But that has all kinds of problems with it, right? Who's the one to say to be the certifier of Drupal people? Do you have to pay to get certified to be a Drupal? How does that work? And I actually think Certified to Rock is an excellent solution for that problem. What it does is you can put in your Drupal.org username, and it will spit back out a score of how much contribution you've made to Drupal. It'll tell you, if you put in trees in there and it gets an 11, the scores go up to 11. It's like a joke from this is fun, Tom. Thank you. So the highest score you can get is 11. You know, most people are way, way lower than that. But what it really did was, in a very quick one-number score, show you, how much contribution this person has made to the Drupal community. There are some obvious benefits to that. That means that in order to become a Drupal rock star, according to these people, that in some way makes you more hireable, you have to contribute to the project itself. The actual algorithm for what increases your score was never released because then it could easily be gamed by somebody, right? But, I think it's a cool tool. It's been somewhat abandoned. It's still around. It's still up, but the index hasn't been updated in some time. And I'd like to see it updated because I have a score. And I've been around for a year or two, so I'd like to see it. But anyway, I think another example of a good motivator that we have in the community already are the user pages on Drupal.org itself, right? There's checkboxes that you can put there that say, I contribute patches, I give support in IRC. There are badges on the side that say, I've contributed to, or I'm a member of the Drupal Association, right? We have this intuitive sense already in our heads that people want to display this information about themselves. It's something that they feel proud about. It's something that gives them their own sort of intrinsic ownership over their work and their work on the Drupal project. And we've already got this built here, and I think it's really great. One other piece that I think is really awesome here, which I didn't put in the bullet points, but is important to note, is this mentors field that we have on Drupal.org profiles now. It says, these are the people that have mentored me into becoming the person that I am right now in the Drupal project. And that, I think, is really great. Also, like I said before, as the code base continues to grow, as the number of people contributing to Drupal will grow, we're going to need to also scale up the educational systems that we have around Drupal so that more people are doing mentoring. We should be really, really, really kind of extolling those people and saying thank you for the work that they're doing. If you ever hung out in IRC before, there's the bot in there, DrupalCon, and you can give, you can say a person's username +++, and it will give them a little bonus point according to the DrupalCon, and people may not even know, you can ask the DrupalCon for what your score is, for how many people have plus you, or you can go to the DrupalCon website, and it's all listed there, and Tim Plunkett is at the top of this list with 1,800 people who have said thank you by giving him a +++. It's also interesting to note, I don't know if you can see it, that the bottom score is 1337, so somebody has gamed this and made himself the worst, but also the leadest person. Anyway, sorry. So I think this is a really interesting tool because it's community power, right? It's not just like you can't game this because it's people that have to have, I guess somebody gamed it, but it's people that have to give you the +++, right? People have to be the ones that make this score real. And we'll talk about some other communities and the tools that have that. But I think this is great motivation. You can help somebody, and they'll give you the +++ afterwards. That's going to make you feel good. It's a little bit of an extrinsic motivator, but that's not all. So that's some of the tools we have already. There's one big tool, which is the one I guess I'm most qualified to talk about. So I'm going to talk about the module off, which is a website that I run that is trying to motivate people to learn more about Drupal as well. So the module off is a website where I run two-week development challenges. I give you a very simple Drupal challenge. People will code up something in response to the challenge and submit it. And then there's a prize for the winner, and that's provided by several different Drupal vendors. For example, hosting vendors, video lessons, all these things, subscriptions to Drupalized, Drupalize Me, example, and I come out and I find these vendors, and they offer up a free prize for anybody who wins. And the competitions last for 2 weeks, and it provides a little bit of motivation for somebody to come in and try something new, learn something new, and give it back to the community afterwards. Also, after the competition is over, the submissions are made public so that anybody who, so that after the fact, if anybody's searching for the topic of the challenge, they can come upon the solution. So I'll give you an example. We had a challenge that was create a views plugin, anything you want to do. And a bunch of people submitted to that one. And so the hope is, and I have their solutions are published on the internet now along with that challenge. The hope is somebody who's later on Googling, I need to learn how to do a views plugin, maybe they'll come upon these solutions, they'll find the winner, they'll have that certified as a good solution, a good answer to the question, and they can take advantage of that resource afterwards. We have about 300 registered users. It's very difficult for me to figure out exactly how many people have registered because of the amount of spam, but I think there's a little over 300 people, real people who've actually registered, and they get, emails and stuff about it, and we've had, pretty solid participation. I'll just briefly get into this. People always ask me about how I came up with this idea, and it's kind of a funny story, so I'll tell you. I have this really bad habit of, late-night domain registrations. Does anybody else suffer from the same, Yeah, I have, I was thinking about this cat laser toy idea. I have, kittycams.com, and, I don't know how to get into it. But I was watching the challenge. You may know it as the Real World Road Rules Challenge on MTV, it's a silly show where they put very volatile people together and have them do physical challenges. I had this funny idea in my head because I wasn't even really watching TV. I was just sitting at my laptop coding, and I had this funny idea. What if we actually put a bunch of core Drupal developers or experienced Drupal developers in a room together and force them to do coding challenges, and would it get all crazy like it does on the MTV show? That's kind of what originally inspired it, and I was like, oh, let me try to figure out a good theme for it, and I registered the modulize.com as an idea. And then as I started to mature the idea a little bit in my head, I said, this could actually be pretty easy to do. If I can find some vendors to offer up the prize for free, I already have hosting, this could be something that's totally free for me to put together and would be a nice benefit for the community if after the fact the challenge was out there for people to see. And all I really have to do is a little bit of marketing. And so that's how I came up with the idea. It was literally inspired by MTV, so I guess we can thank them for that. It really hasn't been a ton of work for me to do, because all I really had to do was put the site together at first and then do a little bit of marketing and some emailing around to ask people to sponsor a challenge. Also, people often ask me about how did I actually implement it, so I'll just talk about this very briefly. It's a little bit, how I did it. It's a couple of weeks of development time in my spare time. It uses the Omega theme. It's responsive. It's my first responsive site. It doesn't look beautiful on a phone, but it works. I also have the Twitter and MailChimp modules in there so that when people sign up, they get the newsletter, and if people submit something, the site kind of tweets out about it to try and spread the word. And there's a blog on there that gets syndicated on Drupal Planet, so just trying to get the word out as best I can. I'm here today also to kind of get the word out a little bit. If you're interested, you should definitely check it out. It's moduleoff.com. Let me talk a little bit about some of the challenges that I had putting this together. If anyone's ever tried to run a international contest, it's a very difficult thing to do even for big companies. And so technically in the official rules, it says that you have to be from the United States to participate. People have been very, very upset about that. I'm sorry, I just don't have a legal team to deal with it. Some countries you actually have to register if your contest has a real value prize. Some countries you have to actually register that contest I'd have to register a contest every 2 weeks in that country. And I just don't have the resources to do that, unfortunately. But I'll say with a wink, and maybe we could pause the recording for a second, that if I don't know where you're from, then I'm not going to stop you from participating. I'm just a guy, just some guy, right? I've never even presented at a DrupalCon before, so who am I to be the one to judge these modules, right? So the very first competition, I actually threw down a little bit of my own cash to offer an Android tablet as the prize, because I wanted to try and generate some interest. And so we got a lot of interest. We had 11 different people submit a module, which I was super appreciative of. One of those people is a very prolific core contributor and a very, very good Drupalist. And that person did not win and was a little bit upset about it. And perhaps that person should have won if I trust their knowledge of Drupal pretty well. And so this gave me this idea, like, maybe I shouldn't be the sole arbiter of who wins these things. And so for challenges where I've had a lot of submissions, I've invited some people. I know Dave Reed has helped out, Tim Plunkett has helped out, to actually look at some of the solutions and help me to make sure I'm making the right decision. Another thing is that interest has kind of faded over time. Maybe it's because I'm not offering an Android tablet anymore, but, you know, we still get a submission or two for every challenge, but the interest isn't there as much. And I'm hoping, you know, this presentation and a little bit more marketing effort from me can bring it back up. But I think it's a powerful tool, and hopefully we can get some of the interest back to it. There's also been some skepticism early on. A lot of people have been, you know, been a little bit skeptical. I don't know this guy, Dave. I actually really appreciate this feedback, so I'm not calling him out here at all. This is right after I came out with it. It says, my verdict on the Drupal competition site, the module off, stay away. By submitting an entry, they own your code, and strictly open to U.S. citizens. So he actually dove into the legalese that I had downloaded boilerplate from some other site somewhere and read through all of it and saw that I actually owned the code at the end of it. And I appreciated this feedback because I changed it so that the code is eventually published under the GPL, but I don't own it. But people have been skeptical of this thing from the start. They think somehow I'm trying to benefit it. When I talk to the vendors that I'm trying to get to sponsor these things, they're like, what's going on here? Like, are you just doing this? How does this benefit you? And I say, you know, I get a little notoriety, that's about it. You know, people actually think that I'm just posting these challenges because I'm trying to get people to do my work for me. Like, oh, I need to do this piece of functionality. Can somebody please do it for me for free? That's not the case. I'm just doing this as a resource for the community. But I can, you know, people are skeptical, and I appreciate that. But it's been a challenge to try to convince people that this is something that's worthwhile to do. We've also had some successes. Like I said, the very first challenge had 11 different people to take it on, and it's, you know, it's hours of their lives that they put down to try and make one of these modules and make a screencast explaining it. I thought that was a great success. I found sponsors for 10 different challenges. These are vendors from the Drupal community who are offering up their product for free. Super appreciated for that. It's been very successful finding them. There's a project called Drush Issue Queue Extras, which is a result of the module. I'll read this quote. It's from Greg Anderson. He's one of the Drush maintainers and also the author of this extension. It says, the module off Drush challenge was the perfect motivation for me to finally pick up this idea and implement it. Due to my limited time, I had to pick something that I thought I would implement eventually anyway, but without the motivation of the competition, it might have been a long time before I managed to get to it. That's by Greg Anderson. That just, like, you know, that warm, fuzzy feeling that I said with the woo-hoo and the tweet in the beginning, it's the same idea. Like, when I finally had somebody speak out loud to me that this site had provided them the motivation to give something back to the rest of the community, made me feel so good about what I was doing. I think that there's probably other people where this is the same way. They just didn't email it to me afterwards. This module is actually really cool. It's a Drush extension where you can post a patch to the issue queue from the command line, which is amazing. Anyway, the point is, we have had some success in motivating people to actually build something for everyone else to give back to the community with the code that they wrote for the challenges. Got a couple ongoing issues. I'm actually seeking co-maintainers. If there's anybody in the room who thinks this is an interesting idea and wants to get involved, please, I'm going to be gone for like the whole summer. We're going to a summer camp, and I'd love to have somebody help me stay on top of this. I'm having some trouble finding the time to market it. And the more responses I can get, the better. I'm running low on people to turn to, and I don't want to swing back to the beginning. It's only been like a month or two. So if you're a vendor in the room, if you're somebody else in the room that wants to, you know, donate a couple dollars or donate a piece of their product to sponsor more competitions, please come on by afterwards and talk to me or send me an email or something. We'd love to have you sponsor this project. Okay, so that, you know, is the whole module off piece, and again, we're talking about that in the context of trying to motivate people to contribute to core the first time to learn Drupal more and more. I'm going to show you a couple of other tools from other communities, and then I'm going to wrap it up. Just with a call to action to think about stuff. So have you ever used, anybody used Ubuntu and ever been to ubuntuforums.com? Thank goodness for the site. This is like taking me through the darkest of days. My very first year of teaching in high school, for whatever reason, because I'm an idiot, I decided to install Linux on my laptop, you know, in a Windows XP environment, trying to print to their copy machines and everything. Thank goodness for this website, because it, like, you know, in your first year of teaching, it's also the deepest, darkest, terrible year of your life also. That's just the way it's going to be. Thank goodness for this website, because it took me through the, you know, when my audio stopped working, that thank goodness I had this website. But they have a system on the side of all of your forum posts, and there's plenty of forums that have a similar thing that has these little images that represent how long a person has been on the site and how many times they've posted to the site, right? So this UCLA geek here at the top, this is the first time he or she has ever posted. They have 3 green coffee beans and 1 slightly brown coffee bean, slightly roasted. And then this person who's been here for much, much longer has, like, really advanced kind of coffee cups and Java and who knows what. I bet that this person praised him or something. I bet they don't really care at this point what kind of coffee cups they have. But maybe in the beginning when they first signed up for the site, they saw these people who were helping everybody else and posting to these forums, and those coffee cups gave them a little bit of motivation to get started. Stack Overflow, another site that I have so many thank yous for because it's the answer to all of my problems. I assume you guys have seen this site too. This is the same idea, except instead of just posting to get you points, people upvote you and they say, yes, that's correct. I'm going to connect it. And there's a community that is kind of curating the people who get these points, right? You hit the check mark to say that answer is correct, and boom, you get 30 extra points, whatever the number is. People upvote your answer, they say that's the right one, you get more points. So this is kind of like the DrupalCon karma system, where it's a social system that actually gives people more status within the community. And I think that could be really powerful for Drupal as well. There's also, for the designers out there, there's a site called Drupal. Have you ever heard of this site? It's got 3 B's. Just saying. It's a design-oriented community. It's very sort of open-source design community. Basically, people post up their Photoshop files, their templates, UI kits, stuff like that, things that they want to get back and give around so anybody can use. But they have really, really good social tools on this site, right? There's this concept of favorite or likes or whatever, and there's also this concept of bucket. So as I'm going around, oh, I like that, I can click like on that, and the tools or the contributions that get the most likes will bubble up to the front page of the site. There's also this concept of a bucket where I can gather up all the different things that I like into my own personal buckets, so I can come back to them later. Also has the concept of the follower, like Twitter style, where I can follow another designer because I really like what they're doing, and I can watch what they're doing as they go along. Now, this kind of concept is something we can also really use on Drupal.org, I think. If you could follow a core contributor and see the work that they're doing, I think that'd be awesome. If you could, you can follow individual issues, but can you see what other issues, can you see what other people are following, what issues they're following? Can you pull a bunch of issues into a bucket of some kind and share that out? Are there better tools that we can have to create a little bit more social community around contributing to core? I think that would be really, really awesome. That's a couple of tools from a bunch of other different communities that we can think about ways to attach to the Drupal core development experience and to Drupal.org to sort of increase the social tools that we have there. I think that would be really great. So given that, what's my point here? What am I talking about? I think, and as I said in the beginning, as the number of files in core continues to grow, as the number of concepts and complexity in core continues to grow, as the number of people using Drupal continues to grow, I think we also need to continue to grow our systems around educating people and motivating people to Drupal. We've got, actually, I think, really, really good tools for mentoring new people. We've got core office hours and lots of great documentation and lots of people, video sites, and all kinds of really good ways to teach people Drupal. But we haven't at all really touched the idea of motivating them to learn it, to contribute to it for the first time. Right? I think that's a separate issue, and I think it's something that we really need to think about. What kind of tools can we build to help people to do it? I built the module off. It's a small little attempt at it that's separate from the community. I think we need to start folding stuff like that, though not specifically competitiveness, into Drupal.org itself, and I'll talk a little bit about that in a second. So, one of the big things I think we need is more motivational tools on Drupal.org. I think the same kind of thing that you see on Stack Overflow, Drupal, the indicators of longevity and their contribution levels should be on Drupal.org itself, right? I mean, we have Certified to Rock, which can tell you how much contribution somebody has made. I think it'd be great if that sort of stuff was on Drupal.org itself. We have to just be careful about doing it in a way that doesn't stop people from contributing unless their score goes up, right? We talked about before, we don't want these extrinsic motivators like points and social status to get in the way of people contributing just for the sake of doing it. I think it can be done. I think it can be done in a really smart way. I also think some of the tools I was just talking about from Drupal to help people kind of grow an online social community a little bit more around, we have groups.drupal.org connect on topics that they're interested in, but we need to have the tools on Drupal.org itself for helping people connect around core contribution. That's a separate issue. And then I think that there's some room for more fun competition in the Drupal community. I think the module off is a nice start. I think it needs to grow if it's going to have more of an effect. But I think that these kinds of competitions, and there's other ones out there in the world, there's one called JS1K, where people put together these JavaScript applications that have to be less than 1K in size, and people compete over them. I think it's really important that we can, you know, keep the food, the food fun and light, and also to encourage Drupal vendors to get involved. I think it's a really nice way to sponsor a challenge like this for a Drupal vendor to kind of encourage people to push the product forwards without specifically sponsoring a piece of functionality within Drupal, right? So a vendor can be like really interested in, oh, I want this to happen in Drupal, and people may, you know, reject that idea. They don't want to feel like there's any corporate control over Drupal itself. But if they want to push Drupal forward in general, sponsoring a challenge like this, getting the community around kind of fun activities that spread the word about Drupal, that encourage people to try and motivate them to continue their work, I think would be a nice solution as well. I'm going to tell a brief story. I work at a summer camp in the summers. It's up in Maine. It's called Winnebago. It's for boys. We have a softball league that we play that has 13, 14, and 15-year-olds in it, and also counselors, right? So you can imagine, when I'm playing in that game, I'm a fairly large gentleman. If there's a tag play at home and there's a 13-year-old running from home, I used to be a physics teacher. I know a little bit about momentum. That's not going to end very well. What we do at camp is we don't have tag plays in that league, right? We just want to have that. We're playing softball to have fun. It's not a super competitive thing. If we want to add competition to the Drupal community, we have to have the same kind of mentality about it. If we have that kind of programmer mentality where everybody's kind of flexing their muscles and just competing with each other to show how awesome they are and not for the sake of the fun and the just gentle competitiveness, this is going to hurt us. But having some fun competitions where people are doing it as a contribution and just to play around with each other, I think can actually help quite a bit. I'm going to give you a little Morton profanity warning here before I click next to the next slide so you can put earmuffs on or something if this is going to offend you. I think the absolute best way to motivate contributors, though, is to make sure that Drupal kicks ass. Because, like I said before, the number one way to motivate people to work on Drupal is to use intrinsic motivators. And I think the number one way to do that is to make it so if I'm going to contribute to core and learn Drupal, I'm going to do it because Drupal is so awesome that I want to be a part of that. So that same woohoo moment that I had at the beginning on that tweet, okay, is something that everybody can share because when they contribute to core or they learn something about Drupal, they feel great about it because Drupal is so awesome and there's so many people using it that they feel like their contribution has value. You know what I mean? Intrinsic motivation is the most powerful tool that we have, and the people are only going to be intrinsically motivated to contribute to Drupal if they feel like Drupal is valuable and the community values the work that they're doing. And so the number one way that we can motivate people is to make sure that Drupal continues to be awesome. And the number one way we can do that, it's kind of the catch-22, is to motivate people to contribute to core and continue to grow our motivational tools in addition to our education tools and the tool of Drupal itself. Cool. I want to thank you guys so much for listening to what I have to say. I really encourage you to check out moduleoff.com. We're going to start another challenge in a day or two. It's going to be a theming only challenge. So if you're not a deep developer and you just like CSS, this is the purpose challenge for you. It's just going to be a CSS only challenge. So I really appreciate it. Thank you so much for coming, and we're going to do questions if you have any. Thanks. Yeah, so I'm not sure if anybody has questions, but if you do, just pop over to the microphone in the center, and we'll be happy to answer anything.
Hey, Mike.
How's it going?
Good job with moduleoff.
Thank you.
I think it's great seeing an innovation with how Drupal is used in the environment. And I build startups myself. And when I build startups, I learn from successes and from failures. And every time you do something, you get more what I call data points that help you make better decisions.
Yep.
So since you've run moduleoff, you saw like 10 competitions on there with a varied amount of prizes and a varied amount of people participating. What do you think worked the best to get people motivated to contribute to it, and what didn't work at all that you thought would have worked?
Yeah, it's interesting. I should have touched on this earlier. One of the things that I've done lately that I thought was going to work but hasn't really changed anything was to change the style of the challenge itself, because I think that's important. Some of the original challenges were very specific. Click on this link and have it change a date field using Ajax. That was like the very first challenge. And I've tried to generalize them a little bit more to make them, A, a little bit less challenging, and B, to allow allow people to kind of maybe fold in a challenge to the actual work that they're doing. So the more recent ones have been like create a views plugin, create a Drush extension, not create a Drush extension that does X, but just create a Drush extension. And that's been somewhat effective. I think it's brought some people in, but I think it's also kept some people out because the actual difficulty of the challenge is not very high, so they don't have that challenge piece to it. So I thought that was going to work, and it didn't. The other thing that I think has worked well is I changed, I added a little bit more Twitter integration into it. I think the social component of this is more important than I've given credit to, where after you submit something, there's a little, you know, you get to a page and it says, thanks so much for submitting. Here's a link to tweet about what you just did. It's not going to give you any bonus points, but it will increase your overall karma. And people have been doing it. So I've seen the traffic coming from Twitter. Twitter's the number one place other than Drupal plan that I get traffic from. So there's been a lot to learn. It's been a really interesting ride. There's a lot I've been able to apply to all sorts of different stuff.
Great, thank you.
Yeah, no problem.
So there's no one else behind me. I have one other follow-up question.
Sure.
So you mentioned a bunch of different gamification techniques from the Drupal developer's perspective. You mentioned like there's comments, your plus, certified to rock, et cetera, and I'm sure you've talked with many core developers as well. What have you seen as like the best reason why a Drupal core developer continues to do it? Like what gives them that little extra hype to continue doing it?
Yeah, I popped in IRC a couple of times just to ask core developers the answer to that question, to say, you know, what is the number one reason that motivates you? And they always give me the same answer. It just says, the community. That's all they say. And I try to press them for what that means. A community doesn't really inspire you to do anything. Maybe it does, but there has to be another step there. It's like, okay, you're a part of the community. And what feeling do you have as a part of that actually motivates you to contribute? I think the answer to that is, when you do something, if you're part of this community and you know these people and you know the people that are going to benefit from the work that you're doing, it gives you that real motivation that's like, oh, I'm going to do this, and it's not just going to be because it's going to make my life easier, it's going to make a lot of people's lives easier. And so really, I think that's the biggest thing. I think, you can do charitable stuff and whatever, or you can do charitable stuff and know the people that you're giving this bonus to. And you're going to appreciate that work a lot more for yourself if you do it otherwise. So I think that's the answer. But I don't know.
Sure. Quick comment about the karma. Actually, the guy that's at the bottom is a guy named Sir Fitchy. He's a German community member, really involved. If you ask DrupalCon, I encourage everyone to ask DrupalCon about Sir Fitchy. You'll get a German response. But the short answer is that Drupal lower weights, rise to the top, so he considers himself the best. Aside from that, I was kind of curious about the 2-week timeline and if there's any notions of like how that affects people submitting, and obviously it plays into the complexity of the problems that can be solved with that timeline. So if you have anything.
It was a totally arbitrary decision on my part. I just came up with it because I thought that seemed like the right level for the original kind of challenges that I had come up with. But it's an interesting idea to play with that a little bit more. Really, I haven't heard from people, and maybe that's a feedback that I'd like to hear. I haven't heard from people that's not enough time. But usually the challenges are not super, super complex. I used to ask people to also make a screencast, and I've dropped off that, and that certainly takes time to maybe practice and then submit and upload to YouTube and so on. But maybe I should play with that a little bit. Maybe that'll help. Maybe shorter ones might motivate people to get right on it, and maybe longer ones will give people the time that they need to really finish up.
Have you thought of involving this into a Kickstarter for Drupal modules and themes and things like that?
Yeah, there's similar. Absolutely. One of the things that I thought about as this started to progress, somebody suggested to me was to take suggestions for the challenges from nonprofits or charitable organizations that are actually have a need, for the module that's being developed. I'm not sure that I want to do it where it's something that people are going to pay to make something happen, although that's an interesting idea. But I had thought about the idea of having the challenges not just be for the sake of doing it, but actually get some benefits and good after it. But I appreciate the question. That's a good idea.
Yeah. And then where are the challenges? Like who comes up with the challenges? Do you?
Yeah, just me. There's a button on the side of the site that says propose a challenge.
Yeah.
So anybody can email me and come up with it, send an idea. And I've had a couple really good ones. This next one, this CSS only one, was a suggestion from somebody else. And I really appreciate it because I'm kind of stuck in my own mind. I'm mostly a back-end developer. I don't do a lot of CSS. I have a very working man's knowledge of CSS. But, you know, including some themers is, you know, just as important. So, I have the opportunity for people to suggest ideas. And that's really welcome feedback as well.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, cool. Thank you guys so much. I also want to thank all the vendors, which I should have put a list out here somewhere of all the vendors who have helped in. But if you go to moduloff.com and look back at the prizes, you can see the vendors that have supported the site. I really appreciate all the work they've done. So thank you all so much for coming. I really appreciate it.